Hey there, everybody. This is Coach Dreema, and I wanted to share this presentation with you. I originally did it, and there was no sound. So I hope you enjoy this recording, this presentation. What I'll be sharing in this presentation are the five reasons that most coaches are broke. Five reasons that most coaches are broke, and the mistakes to avoid, and what to do about those mistakes so that you won't do them again. And I'm really passionate about that because these are the same mistakes that I did in my organizing business as well as my coaching business. And so I'm sharing these five mistakes with you so that you won't do them. So enjoy the recording. Let me know what you think about the recording. Let me know if you got value. And I will see you on the other side. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Hello there. This is Coach Dreema, and welcome to the five reasons why most coaches are broke. Know these strategies, and you will be able to break the cycle. Now, before I get into the training here, I wanted to make sure that I said a little bit about the word broke, okay? Because as I was working on content for this webinar, I've just felt the need to clarify or say a little bit about the title. You know, I wanted to, really catch your attention and, because, I don't know, I just wanted to catch your attention. And so I used the word broke, but, and I could have used another word like struggling or challenged or something like that, but that seemed to be a little bit too mild for me. So I wanted, like I said, maybe I should have used another word. However, let me just say this about broke. The word, I'm sure, brings up a negative, negativity and a negative connotation. But the broke is a state of mind. And I'm not suggesting that anyone that's on this presentation, on this call, on this webinar is broke, okay? You may be lacking in some available resources or struggling in your business due to some, skill set or what have you. Or maybe you've just hit a threshold and you can't seem to cross over or move beyond a certain level in your business. But you are not broke, okay? You're not broke. So we're going to take that out of our vocabulary, but for the sake of this presentation and for the sake of catching your attention, we'll just, let that go for now, but you are not broke, okay? Now that I've got that out in the way, gotten that out of the way, I feel a little bit better about that. Okay, so let me just do a little bit of housekeeping. Sorry about that. I want you to take notes, write down your questions, and, make sure that, you're not being distracted, your phone is not ringing or, anything like that. Make sure you take down some of these notes. And if anything resonates with you or you think it, may help someone else in some way, then share the information with your friends or someone you think that will benefit from this training, okay? I'll be sharing an offer, of course, at the that I'm really excited about at the end of the webinar. However, I just want you to take advantage of the value and the content that I'll be providing in this training. Now, so let's get started. Okay, so welcome to the webinar, and I'm glad that you're here. Let me go ahead and start by introducing myself to some of you who may have no idea who I am or, may have never heard of me or what have you. My name is Aldrema Harper, and I'm known as Coach Dreema. I've been a professional organizer for probably about 13 or 14 years, but I transitioned my business to a coaching model because I love to teach and coach people as opposed to, coming in and doing it for them and as I did in my organizing business. I would do the work for them, but in my coaching practice, I empower people to do it themselves. And so now I just get to teach entrepreneurs like yourself how to leverage your time, how to leverage systems and resources in order to create, build, and grow amazing businesses. I'm also a wife of 17 years and a mentor to some amazing young ladies who come to me for guidance. Now, I do have to say this as well. It's been a challenging transition. However, it's been an amazing journey to transition from professional organizing to coaching. And I'm still on the journey, you know. And so that's why we're here today, because what I wanted to share with you are the five mistakes that coaches make. And this is not just for coaches. This is for people who are in, you know, a service business, and you know, they may be challenged or struggling, you know, in their service businesses as well. So this does apply to you as well. And these five, you know, mistakes are mistakes that coaches frequently make, and they're some of the same mistakes that I made early on in my business. These are mistakes that kept me from really profiting, and they will keep you from profiting as well. So learning about these mistakes, these common mistakes, will set you ahead of other coaches and other entrepreneurs. But you won't just learn what to avoid, you'll also understand what actions you need to take as well. So I want to thank you for investing your time with me today. So make sure you, like I said, grab yourself your notepad, your pen, get comfortable. So within this 45 minutes to an hour, I'll make sure that I, you know, provide as much value as possible. Okay? All right, so let's get started. Let's dive in. All right, so we're going to start with number one. Okay? Mistake number one. Now, mistake number one: chasing clients instead of creating credibility. Chasing clients instead of creating credibility. There are two ways to chase clients incorrectly. Number one is chasing clients when nobody knows you. Okay? And number two is continuing to chase clients after you've landed the first couple of clients, instead of focusing on turning the couple of clients that you've landed into raving fans and successful examples of what your coaching skills are, or whatever your business is, you know, your skill sets that you brought to them that provided them value, how it empowered them, how it moved them to the next level in terms of where they were trying to go. Okay? First, people have to want to be coached. Okay? They have to want to be coached. I remember hearing this in a movie. Some years ago, you know, somebody said, you know, you can't save somebody that doesn't want to be saved. Well, the same thing applies here. Okay? You can't coach somebody that doesn't want to be coached. So, your number one, as I said before, you're chasing clients instead of creating credibility. So, when you create credibility, you are doing the things that you need to do in order to attract the type of people that want to be coached to you, right? Okay, because that's what you want. You want people that want to be coached. Okay, so like I said, other mistakes, the mistakes are chasing clients before people get to know you, and chasing the clients instead of focusing on the ones that you have. It's a very, very common mistake. And like I said, people have to want to be coached. Now, let me say this as well, just to kind of share, you know, a little bit of my journey. My biggest struggle in my business, particularly early on, was intimidation, lacking fear, confidence, and that type of thing. And so when you are in that place, you know, then your clients they're gonna feel that, okay? You're not gonna land any clients. You're not going to, you know, get the right clients. You're gonna get people that wanna take advantage of you, that wanna, you know, pimp you. I couldn't think of another word. But anyway, you have to know when you are ready, okay? Because again, you will have trouble getting clients. And if you don't feel like you're ready, then again, that fear and that intimidation is going to keep showing up in your conversations, okay? So you definitely want to make sure that you are in a place of confidence, in a place where you are sure that what you have in your business, your coaching, your service business, or whatever it is, that you can provide what they need. You have to be in that place in order to get the type of clients that, you know, that you want. Now, and, you know, as I was saying that, you know, a few minutes ago, as I started to say, I kept feeling that intimidation and that fear. It was showing up in my conversations. And so, you know, some of the things that I did was I would overcompensate in other areas, okay? And what I mean by that is in a discovery session with a potential client or prospect, I was on a call for 2.5 hours one time trying to convince someone that they needed my coaching, right? 2.5 hours. And guess what? They never did sign up for anything. Because first of all, I gave them way too much information. Secondly, I didn't charge them. Thirdly, they didn't want to be coached. And fourth, because I had given them so much, they didn't see any value. It's like, why would I continue? You've given me everything that I needed. And so I missed out on numerous opportunities, and I left money on the table. And I did that because I was not in a place of confidence. I was not in a place where I felt like, you know, I was capable. So I felt like I just had to prove to them that I was capable of doing the job. So, wow, don't do that, okay? All right. So let me move on a little bit. Let's run down a quick internal checklist so that you know when you're ready to coach. Now, we're still talking about, you know, chasing clients instead of credibility, okay? What I was doing in that scenario, I was chasing the client, okay, instead of chasing my credibility. Now, you know, this was a client that didn't want to be coached, and so that was a scenario that you really, really don't want to be in, okay? So let me just move on. I think I've done that. I've stayed on that point long enough. Okay, so the one thing that – this is how you know when you're ready to coach, okay, because we're still talking about chasing clients and instead of credibility, okay? You must understand what coaching is, okay? You must understand the difference between mentors and coaching. It's another trap that you can find yourself in if you're not ready for coaching, okay? So you'll find yourself in situations where you're trying to prove something to them, and you'll also find yourself in situation where you'll be coaching, you know, someone for 2 hours who's not ready for your coaching, right? So, number one, mentors are those who have had success in your niche, right? It's a common misconception, you know, that, you know, between, or should I say, knowing the distinction between the mentors and the coaches is very common, and it's a common misconception that coaches, you know, have had to walk the walk and become the masters in the exact niche that the clients want to master, okay? That is not true. That is the difference between a mentor and a coach, okay? So mentors are those who have had success in your niche. If you are a mentor, then that's fine, but know the difference, okay? Coaches only have to be brilliant at coaching, okay? Coaches are for people who already have developed some skills, developed the skills that you need, and the client, they just need to know the best way to apply those skills that you have developed and which steps to take, you know, that will be best for their lives and their businesses and their situation. So coaches will help clients to make decisions for themselves. In the instance that I was just sharing with you, that 2.5 hour conversation that I had, I was trying to convince her to make a decision, right? You know, and the thing was, I wasted so much time and left so much money on the table because not only was I wasn't really trying to help her bring out the skills that she had, I was giving her the answers, okay? And that's the difference between the mentors and the coaches, okay? So you really want to know the difference between the two so that when you set out in your coaching practice, you're not doing the same thing that I did, okay? You just want to help them to bring out the skills and qualities and talents that they didn't know that they had, okay? You help them to boost their confidence and encourage them in critical thinking and self-analysis. You know, you're there to cheer them on and things like that, but you also want to encourage them in critical thinking and really sound self-analysis, okay? So it's a little bit more than just being, you know, cheering them on, okay? All right, so that knowing the difference between mentors and coaches and what to do in those scenarios will really help you to not chase, you know, the wrong people, okay, and in the wrong way, okay? So a coach will help clients make decisions for themselves, help boost confidence in making critical and critical thinking, and coaches help clients to bring out skills and talents their clients didn't know that they had. All right. So, understanding the difference between the two is one way, okay? Another way, because what we're doing is I'm giving you the solutions to stop chasing clients. All right? So, proof. You need proof that you're the perfect coach for your ideal client, right? Once you thoroughly understand the coaching model, which we just talked a little bit about, and you've gained, you know, a little bit of knowledge of, in terms of what that looks like, okay, you'll need to just have something that will give you some credibility, okay? Now, you can do that by writing a book, okay? By writing a book. And nowadays, it's become not only acceptable, you know, to self-publish digitally, but it's almost expected, really. You know, so write a book, a signature book, and it doesn't have to be long, you know, a dissertation or anything like that, but just something that that proves to your client that that you know what you're talking about, okay? In the 2.5 conversation, what I should have done in that scenario was pointed her to a place where she could just purchase my book, and then she would have, and she could have, you know, made the decision whether or not to sign up or not, or, you know, read the book or not, or purchase the book or not. But that would have cut down on that 2.5 conversation, and you know, and time, really. So write a book, okay? Publish your signature book. Do it via Amazon, Kindle. Kindle publishing, like I said, is accepted and expected, really, like I said, in the business world. So this demonstrates what you have to offer to your reader, okay? All right. And just a little bit more about the book. It should include your coaching philosophy, your coaching and communication style, maybe some stories that prove and illustrate what you are talking about, everything that you're most passionate about, because people want to know, like, and trust you, okay? One of the mistakes that I even made in hiring a coach, this was years and years ago when before I was still in my organizing business, and I actually hired a coach, and we didn't have the same philosophy, and I didn't realize that until we were already engaged in a coaching relationship, you know? And so there's some things that should have taken place prior to that deeper level of coaching that, you know, I should have done, you know, research or whatever, you know, perhaps they should have had a book, and then, you know, I would have been able to read their book or something. So, you know, but anyway, you know, Your book should include your coaching philosophy, your coaching and communication style, stories that prove and illustrate what you're talking about, and everything that you are most passionate about, and what things that are related to your clients' interests, okay? Make it a self-help workbook, you know, for those who can't afford your coaching at this time, okay? So these are ways that you can show proof that you know what you're doing and what you're talking about, and it's, you know, it's a lower investment, you know, for them to get to know you and to get to even like you. If they agree with what you're saying or it resonates with them, you know, then they're more likely to engage with you on a deeper level. Okay, let's move on. Social visibility is another thing that is crucial to, you know, people being able to, I guess, for lack of better terms, they can engage with you from a distance, but they can start to, you know, the process of knowing, liking, and trusting you, okay? So your job as a coach is to gain some social visibility, okay? Now, you don't need to make social networking into a career, okay? That's not what I'm talking about, but visibility is definitely a plus as long as you make it solid and consistent, okay? If you're a business coach, then you'll want, you know, a page on Facebook. You'll want a page on LinkedIn. If you're a marketing coach and you've written a book, or, you know, you definitely want to be on Facebook. You know, that's a good strategy, creating a Facebook page for your books and or your coaching, okay? And like I said, should be consistent. Consistency meaning you're maintaining a professional demeanor and professional branding at all times in all of your online platforms, okay, your websites, your email list, your social profiles, okay. In particular, you need to make sure that you respond to follow-ups, okay, respond to follow-ups and your readers, okay. If you promise to send an email on the 16th, then do that, okay. Do that. If someone comments on your post, thank them. If someone asks a question, answer it. If someone retweets your tweet or something, give them a shout out or, you know, a thank you. Thank people for commenting on your posts, okay? Send emails regularly. I mean, that is, you know, because you want to stay in front of your prospects, okay? Especially if they have signed up for your email list, you definitely want to stay in front of them on a regular basis. A weekly, you know, email is fine. You know, if you do anything any less frequent than that, they're going to forget about you. So I would suggest at least on a weekly basis, okay? Okay, so let's move on to the next one. I've already covered be consistent to your visitors, subscribers, social media fans, book fans, peers, contractors, etc. So, mistake. Let's just recap. Mistake number one: chasing clients instead of creating credibility. I think I said chasing credibility. I did not mean chasing credibility because that's what I did with the 2.5 hour conversation. Chasing clients instead of creating credibility. Make sure you understand clearly what coaching is and what coaching isn't. You'll also want to make sure that you prove to your clients that you're their perfect choice. And you do that with social visibility, which should be consistent and solid with your social media presence. Okay? All right, let's move on to number two. So, a number two mistake is only offering one-on-one coaching. Oh, there's a lot that I could say about that, because this not only applies to your one-on-one coaching, but if you're in a service business, you're in a service you know, whether you're a contractor or a professional organizer like I was, then you will, if you don't do something about that one-on-one, and let me just say it this way, okay. First of all, you might be saying to yourself, isn't this cost effective or worth my time? Any coach, anyone in the service industry will tell you that one-on-one with a client, whether it's coaching, whether it's services, you know, organizing, it can be emotionally draining, it can be demanding, it can be physically challenging, okay? Because what you're doing is you're spreading yourself thin. Now, I'm not suggesting that you don't have one-on-one coaching. What I am saying is when you're offering only one-on-one coaching, it will and can lead you to be, you know, not even loving your business anymore, not even loving your coaching anymore, because it will be emotionally draining and demanding. You're spreading yourself too thin, and then many clients aren't even ready for that type of relationship, right? They may not be ready to engage with you on a one-on-one basis. It might be too, because they're intense, they may not have the cash, they may not even have the time, you know, to do that. A 6 months, you know, training course may not be what they need at that time. So if you're offering only one-on-one coaching, you're leaving money on the table, okay? So let it be a part of your coaching business, but not the only way you do business, okay? So what do you do in order to counteract that, okay? You should ask yourself if your program is suitable to your clients, or should I say make your program scalable, meaning that you should be able to suit your clients' level, budget, learning preferences, communication preferences, degree of interaction, and time constraints, okay? I mean, you want to be able to engage with them at different points in your business, and you can't do that if you're only offering one-on-one coaching and you're not making your business scalable, okay? So make sure also that you cover more than one model or delivery system, okay? Make sure of that. Now, that could include other options as personal retreats, workshops, or events, telephone coaching. You may have, you know, someone that may be, I don't know, maybe they're a little bit older and, you know, they don't understand perhaps the, you know, the video coaching process or Skype or something like that, and they only want to do telephone coaching, okay? So you want to make sure that you cover more than one model or delivery system in your business. Skype coaching may be the only option for someone else, whereas telephone coaching could be the only option for someone else. Email coaching, that's still viable, right? Membership site coaching, closed elite groups with, you know, fixed access to your time, that's an option. Forum coaching, public, basic, with the most limited access to you and your time. You know, that could be a Facebook group or something like that. So you definitely want to cover more than one model or delivery system. So let's just recap. The mistake is offering only one type of coaching, and which is, you know, one-on-one coaching. Make your business scalable, okay? Adapt your coaching to cover more than one model, more than one delivery system. All right? Okay, so let's move on to mistake number three. This is a big one. No additional streams of income. Let me tell you something. I'm going to say the word broke because you will be broke. Okay? In my professional organizing system, for years I had this one client that was, I mean, to tell you that It was a substantial client, or it was a, I had a big client, okay? Then it got to the point where I think we were, I may have had her for about 5 years. Then it got to the point where it was like, you know what? I think it's time for this to be over. And I think she did too. So we had to end. It was cordial, you know, but it was time for, because number one, she was my main client. And number two, she was a big client. Number three, the mistake that I had was I didn't have any additional streams of income. Okay. I was only doing professional organizing. Just like I was just saying in mistake number two, by having only offering one-on-one coaching, that's what I was offering, and that's not scalable. Okay. So, and again, there were no additional streams of income. So that is mistake number three. So when you have no additional streams of income, you cannot increase your profits. You cannot stimulate new experiences. Okay? So not only will you be adding additional streams of income and increasing your profits, you will have other opportunities to expand your niche. Okay? So expand your influence, excuse me, is what I meant to say. So, but if you only got one thing going, then you don't, you are limiting yourself in terms of other opportunities. Now, I gotta say this too, because I see this happening a lot. When I say no additional streams of income, you know, that sounds really amazing. And I know everybody talks about this, but here's what I see often. I see so many times with newbies and, you know, people starting out businesses is they get the idea of additional streams of income, but they start them too soon. So if you don't get anything else from this mistake right here, is, you know, you're this, I am all about additional streams of income. But do not do this until you have something already working and generating money for you in your business. If you don't get anything else from this, get that, because it will be your downfall and you will end up being broke or struggling or challenged or whatever you want to call it, because people get caught up and it's so easy to do. We get caught up in this shiny object excursion, okay? You know, getting distracted with something else before we have our main thing working, okay? Like I think it's Stephen Covey that says, you know, make sure you make the main thing, okay? And when that is working for you, then you look at additional streams of income. But so many times we see, you know, other, you know, multiple, you know, millionaires or whatever, you know, you want to, however you want to categorize them, gurus or whatever, you see them doing those things and creating and generating other streams of income. But in order for them to get there, I'll bet you if you have that conversation, they will tell you that you should start with one thing, get one thing going, and then look at the other streams of income to add to your coaching business. All right. Okay, I think I've said that enough. So, what can you do? You can try adding digital products. I mean, it's right now is, I mean, is a really good time to have digital products added, you know, to your business. You can have local workshops or community college courses. You can add that to your business model or your coaching model. Speaking engagements. You know, you want to make sure that you know, create a speaker sheet for your website. But speaking engagements is a wonderful way, you know, to do that. Have group coaching. as opposed to the one-on-one, group coaching is another way to add an additional stream of income to your business. Okay. Also, try this is and this is the one thing that I did not do. I should have done this. I'm telling you, these mistakes, I just made so many mistakes, and it just I should have been way further along in my business had I not made these mistakes that I'm talking with you about today. Packages will enhance your coaching versus, you know, one-on-one hourly rates, that kind of thing. That is not a good strategy at all. I'm here to tell you, it just does not work well. You will end up broke. paid subscriptions for your newsletters, paid online training modules, writing for offline magazines. Okay, I mean, there are offline magazines that pay per articles, like Inc. magazine, and, you know, I mean, they're still offline, but there are people out there that I know of that write, and you see them. You see the articles. Well, they're getting paid for these articles, and I'm not saying that's something you can do, you know, right now. It may take some time, but if you're a good writer, that may be an option for you. Okay, let's see, where am I? Okay, so writing for offline magazines, some offline magazines pay per article. On top of that, a higher percentage of offline magazines are used to, you know, they're used to paying high, healthy fees. So compared to online magazine, which usually expects you to write, you know, just for the glory of it, but consider that as an option for you, where you only write once an editor commits to you, okay? All right, let's move on. All right, let me just recap here. So mistake number three, no additional streams of income. Consider packaging to enhance your coaching. Paid subscriptions, paid online training modules, paid speaking engagements, digital products. You can also consider becoming an affiliate, okay? So these are ways that you can add additional streams of income to your coaching business. Okay, number four, not having a deep sales funnel, okay? Many people create a sales funnel, but what they often don't do is create a deep one. And the premise of a deep sales funnel is very simple. You start with the most inexpensive base product, and then you end with your exclusive high-end products, okay? And what this means is if you don't have two-figure products or four or even five-figure products in your sales funnel, it's not considered deep. A deep funnel, okay? So you start with the most expensive, inexpensive base product. You end with an exclusive high-end product. And it may take some time for you to get there, okay? But you just make it a deep sales funnel by having a two-figure product along with your four and five, you know, figure products, okay? And one example of that is let's just say you have an inexpensive base product like, you know, a $7 short report or something like that. Then you have your high end could be something like, you know, a retreat, a week-long exclusive coaching retreat. Boy, I can't even say that. In an exotic location that could be, you know, tens of thousands of dollars. You hear about this all the time. We're attending a lot of them. But, you know, so anyway, enough about that. So, again, that's the example you start with, and you have something in between now. You don't just start with a $7 report, and then all of a sudden you have this, you know, $8,700 retreat, okay? Okay, you don't do that. So I'm talking about the depth of your sales funnel here. Now, what most people seem to do, though, is create all of these products, you know, these little $27 products, $47 products with nothing else, okay? You want people to want more of your services. And when you do this, you're wasting your time when you just create a multitude of $27 products and $47 products and nothing else, that's just a waste of time. Okay, that's just a waste of time, because you got to remember, people are looking for ways to get more of your skills and talents. And if they're thrilled with your coaching, they will pay for your services. Now, let me just get some water here, and then we'll continue. Okay, excuse me. All right, so when you create a really deep funnel, it's also vital that you segment your list. Now, I'm not going to get into a whole lot about, you know, list building or anything like that, because that's a whole different training. You may even already have some training on that. I'm just talking about, you know, for the sake of this training, we're just talking about, you know, building a deep funnel, okay? All right. Okay, and just a little bit about, you know, the funnel, segmenting your list. they will receive, when you segment your list, they will receive a notice of more products at a higher price point. So it is important, you know, to know this when you are creating, or when you are creating a deep funnel, okay? It is important to segment your list. And as your clients' business grow, so do their profits. So they'll be more, you know, able to pay for your higher-end product. And if they can't afford your expensive product now, they might in the future. All right. Always remember this. The key to creating the right mix of products for your sales funnel lies in knowing your ideal purchaser, follower, client, and being able to anticipate what he or she is going to want next. Okay? Also, let me just say this as well. Focus on knowing your customer first. Pricing will naturally flow. Know this, coaching is typically short term. These are some things that you really must remember. Once your client or your coaching relationship, your client has reached, you know, her goals, his or her goals, then that relationship, you know, may end. And I don't mean in a bad way or anything, but it's short term is what I'm saying, you know. So keep that in mind. People will use your services to advance to the next level. So provide the next level of service, or become an affiliate for another coach who offers those services. Okay? This is really, you know, crucial. And what I mean by that is, if you have relationship with other coaches, it is not for you to think that, you know, and we all do. I mean, we know other coaches and stuff, you know, that provide services that's different from ours. And so if you have a relationship with another coach where perhaps you can collaborate with them about an affiliate relationship, and if they have something to offer your client, then you can, you know, recommend that services as they move on and progress in their businesses, right? So remember those things. All right, so let me just recap mistake number four, not having a deep sales funnel. Start with the most inexpensive base product, end with the most exclusive high-end product. Make it deep by having two figure products along with four and five figure products, right? Now we're going to move on to mistake number five, and this is the last one, not investing in yourself. Not investing in yourself. Now, excuse me for a moment. I'm sorry, excuse me. Not investing in yourself. Coaches who don't use coaches themselves are not working to their fullest potential. That's it. Everybody needs a coach. Even people like Oprah or Tony Robbins, they have coaches. They have people who help them to move to the next level. That's why they're successful, okay? And that's why they're, you know, working in their fullest potential, because they have people that help them to and guide them, and they have coaches and mentors, okay? So not investing in yourself is a huge mistake. If you show me a coach who doesn't have a coach, you'll be introducing me to a coach who is not reaching their full potential, okay? Think of coaching sessions, individual or in cluster sessions, as a vital and necessary check-in, okay? As I said, you talk to top-level coaches, and they will happily admit to you that having their own coach, often more than one, even an investment coach, it doesn't matter. They have a coach, okay? So not investing in a coach is a huge mistake, or not investing in yourself, rather, is a huge mistake, because you cannot reach your fullest potential. And as I said, coaching sessions are vital check-ins and accountability. It adds that level of accountability. Top-level coaches often use more than one coach, okay? Now, let me recap that. Mistake number 5, not investing in yourself. I said enough about not reaching your fullest potential, but here's another thing. When you don't want to invest in yourself or have a coach, you're saying that you're not coachable. And to me, that's kind of arrogant. That's kind of, prideful. When you say you're not coachable, you're saying that, well, I know everything. In so many words, that's what you're saying. And so the mistakes that coaches make is they don't invest in themselves, which means to me that they're not coachable. And here's another thing I believe. I totally believe that when you say that you're not coachable, or when you say you don't want to invest in yourself, or you don't want to reach your fullest potential, what happens is you begin to attract those same types of people, okay? The same type of people that you are, you draw. The same type of person you are, that's what you draw. And so you want to attract people that want to invest in you, so you want to invest in yourself. And let me say that a different way, because I think I may have not been clear. You want to attract people who's willing to invest in themselves, right? And because you are an example of a person that invests in yourself. And so you're more likely to have the type of client that you want, because you're showing the same thing to them that you want. Okay? I hope that made sense. But anyway, all right. So, in conclusion, I really hope that this has, you know, resonated with you. I hope that this helps you to avoid these typical mistakes that a lot of coaches make. Okay, I know that we've covered, you know, quite a bit of ground. This is not an exclusive list by any means, but it is a list of the most typical mistakes that a lot of coaches make, a lot of entrepreneurs make, but successful coaching is really more than just avoiding making mistakes, okay? It's about doing something and taking action on it, okay? That's when the transformation begins, all right? So before you rush off to sign up with a new coach or add more coaches to your agenda, let me just offer this easy, easy start. Okay, real easy start to begin to invest in yourself. Here's my offer to you. I can help you be more productive, work more efficiently, and help you build a thriving business. Okay? I can do that for you. Now, if that is you and you're ready to create your coaching business or grow your coaching business, let's have a conversation. Okay? I want you to text me at 972-978-1155 and say, "Coach Dreamer, let's chat." That's it. "Coach Dreamer, let's chat." Okay? And we'll have a 30-minute conversation, and it's no obligation, no commitment. I just want to help you to flesh out whatever it is, whatever challenges you're having in your coaching practice. So text me at that number, and that will begin the conversation. What we'll do is, if you text me, then I can say, we can, you know, set up a time either today, tomorrow, or at a convenient time to have that conversation, right? So that's all you have to say is, "Coach Dreamer, let's chat." Now, I do also have a coaching program that's coming up. June the 15th, and you can find out more about that at freedombiz.info. It is a 4-week program that starts on July the 15th. And if you're interested in that, then by all means, go and check it out. So, listen, there's so many benefits and rewards, you know, to coaching. And if you're trying to build a business, then I want to help you to that to help you to get to that next level. Again, the program starts on June the 15th, and I would love to see you in there. So just go to freedombiz.info. All right. Now, I'm not going to go through, you know, all of the program. You can go and find out more about that there. I want to thank you for being on this with me. I want to thank you for investing your time with me. And I would love to hear from you. I would love to help you in your business. And we can start out with just a conversation. I hope I've given and provided value to you. I'd love to, again, chat with you. I hope that you have a wonderful, wonderful day. And if you need anything, I am here to help. So this is Coach Dreamer signing off. And you have an amazing, amazing day. Be blessed.
Hey guys, thank you so much for joining me on this webinar. I really appreciate it, and I hope you got value from it. I really value your time, and I appreciate you investing time with me on this webinar. So my goal was to really help you to avoid some of the mistakes and some of the traps that you know, and pitfalls that that I had to, you know, going through my business, you know, the two businesses, the organizing business as well as my coaching business. So there were really, you know, twice that, you know, I just made some of the same mistakes. And I just wanted to help you not make those same mistakes and avoid some of those pitfalls. So hopefully, you know, I'll hear from you in terms of a text message and just say, you know, let's chat. It's no obligation, no commitment. Just want to chat with you to see whether or not I can help you any further, see where you are in your business, and, you know, just have a conversation. So make sure that you text me at 972-978-1155. Also, feel free to go and check out the freedombiz.info site, where there's more information and details about the program that's coming up on June the 15th. And if that's something that's of interest to you, then I would love to see you there. So, thank you so much. This is Coach Dreamer, and I hope to speak with you soon. Have a great day. Bye-bye.